everybody. Today is No Smoking Day, and it's very, very appropriate that we're having this lecture this evening from the visitor who's been here with us for the last 2 days. We've just come to the end of a big symposium on breathing in context. And so really the whole idea of sort of No Smoking Day is to clear the air and have smoke-free environments. And you may not know, and I'm sure Marewa will fill us in a bit more about this, but New Zealand is a very interesting country from the point of view of smoke-free futures, because it's one of the few countries in the world that actually has a policy or plan to become tobacco-free, not just smoke-free, but tobacco-free by 2025. And our speaker tonight, Professor Marewa Glover, does work with one of the indigenous community, the Maori community, who have some of the highest smoking rates, or the highest smoking rates in New Zealand. So she has very strong views about the sort of feasibility of the tobacco-free New Zealand 2025, which she's going to share with us. So welcome, Marewa, from Massey University. And the title is A Tobacco-Free New Zealand by 2025. I think we said it was reflections of a frontline activist. It could also be confessions of a frontline activist, I don't know. But,
no confessions.
Over to you. And yeah. I should mention this is being filmed by Marewa's friend Dave from Vapor Trails TV. And so if anybody, he's not going to be pointing the camera at anybody, might.
All right, thank you very much, Andrew, for that. Now, kia ora koutou. Thank you so much for coming tonight to hear about New Zealand's goal to become the first smoke-free nation in the world, barring Bhutan, which has already banned smoking, the import and sale of smoking, but still a lot of people smoke, and Bhutan is surrounded by other countries. There's no way sort of stopping the cross-border transport of tobacco. So we just sort of ignore that because we're going to be first. So I have, as Andrew alluded to, I've been in tobacco control since the early 1990s, so about 23 years. And I first was working in government policy and public health. Then I moved into a national health promotion role. And then and there was advocacy involved in that. Then I went back to university to do my PhD, and I did that on smoking cessation among Māori, and in-depth qualitative interviews, and followed them through, and some people were going through a Māori-designed stop smoking program. Māori are the indigenous people of New Zealand, and I think we're about 15% of the total population. We also have a very large Pacific Island population that have come down from Samoa, Tonga, all of the islands, and they're about 9% of the New Zealand population now. So the rewards in this work come very slowly, and when I started in tobacco control, more than half of Māori smoked. So later I'll show you how many are smoking now, nearly 20 years later. But first, how did we come to this idea of a smoke-free, to be the first smoke-free nation in the world? Well, how am I going to work this? Okay, that's all right. So, because we're a small country, and we like to see ourselves as independent. Independent can-do people. We can fix anything and we'll just make it work. Because we're small, we know we have to act boldly and we have to do things big and to feature on the world stage. So we've got to win a lot of world rugby games and win a lot of medals at the Olympics. And so being sporty and winning in those contexts is very important, and being big politically is important as well, and doing innovative things first. So we invent crazy things like bungee jumping. Has anyone here done bungee jumping? Oh, good on you. Even I was, I'm too scared to do bungee jumping, but that's me jumping off the Sky Tower, which is a very, our tallest building in Auckland, and you can jump off, but you're attached to wires and sort of slide down. But still, it's an exhilarating experience. So we like to be the first to do things, and that's partly our background. New Zealand was founded by pioneers and explorers. First Māori came down from the Pacific and discovered New Zealand and settled there. And then, of course, hundreds of years later, we had the French and British whalers, sealers coming down fishing, and then the explorers, and then the missionaries, and leading to the British settlement of New Zealand. We did manage to have a treaty, the Treaty of Waitangi, so that was with the Queen, and that was an agreement about being able to retain our culture and the things that are precious to us, our knowledge, our language and practices, and some promise of co-governance in the country. We thought that the English were establishing law to look after and their people, because they were a bit unruly and they were committing crimes and doing stuff. But anyway, of course, it didn't work out like that. So New Zealand was one of the first countries to pass a comprehensive tobacco control legislation. In 1990, we banned advertising of tobacco products. We banned tobacco company sponsorship of events. We banned smoking inside workplaces, but not in bars or restaurants. That came later in 2004. And casinos were exempted for quite a time. We banned sales of tobacco to minors. We banned in-shop advertising. And we've since moved products, as you have, into the grey cupboards. So that was also later legislation, a later amendment. We've implemented the large graphic warnings on our tobacco packaging, and also we've had a long sort of history now of tax increases on tobacco. I think we did have a bit of a break there under one of the governments. Didn't put the tax up for quite some time, and then you could see the prevalence rate, instead of continuing to fall, it plateaued off. So the current government, that are now into their third term, they've re-implemented the tobacco tax increases every year of 10%. They also equalise the tax on loose tobacco, because people were switching from the manufactured tobacco cigarettes to loose tobacco. They could make it go further. It worked out cheaper by grams. So that was a bigger 24% increase on the loose tobacco to get it, to remove that advantage. So for a long time, our tobacco control program was held up as a model for other countries to follow. And it's been pretty much ahead of even what the Framework Convention on Tobacco Control requires of country. It's kind of like, well, we're already there, but so many other countries, it's so far to go. And there was a lot of lobbying on the part probably of the tobacco industry that the New Zealand model would be the ceiling, and as long as other countries sort of slowly move towards that, you know, that would be fine. I think maybe the only there's maybe two clauses New Zealand's still working on. One of them is disclosure of communication and contact with the tobacco industry, so making that more transparent. So, it wasn't until 2000, after the World Conference on Tobacco Control in Beijing, where Richard Peto spoke about tobacco control globally, and that you know, we'd all been focusing so much on reducing uptake among young children, and he stood up and he said, we're not doing anything to stop all of the deaths of all of the people who currently smoke. The pendulum has swung too far. You know, you need to do something about helping the current smokers quit, or all of that death that's on its way is still going to happen. So Māori, we had had a national meeting in 1993. Our top priority was smoking cessation. We said, well, we need to help people stop smoking, but the policy analysts at the time were convinced smoking cessation didn't really work and it wasn't worth the money. And it wasn't until Richard Peto spoke at Beijing and said, no, we need to do cessation as well. So we had a large delegation over there and they all came back and said, right, we have to do cessation. So in 2000, the government funded a national free phone quitline service, so that's a picture of them up there. And we also got a smaller amount of money to establish and pilot a Māori face-to-face stop smoking service. And so that's an early picture of some of the first people that I trained, and there's me in the green quite some time ago. And I had just finished my PhD on smoking cessation at the time, the first person in New Zealand to do a PhD on this topic, and so I was involved in the design of the therapeutic content, what they would actually do in the smoking cessation intervention with Māori. And we strongly based it on Māori models of health as well, and encouraged a more holistic approach, and including family in, you know, not just working with individuals. So that was only in 2000, so only, you know, 15 years ago. Later on, I think that was about 2006, the Māori Party, so we have our own political, we've had a couple of political parties particularly pushing for Māori issues. We actually have, I think it's 8 seats in Parliament, which changes depending on the size of the constituency. So the Māori Party pushed very heavily for funding to assist Māori with stopping smoking. And what happened was, I think they got about $6 million of the budget for subsidising nicotine patches, gum, but it wasn't just for Māori, it was for everybody. So from that point, everyone was able to access subsidised nicotine patches and gum, and you could get quite a big pile for $3, which is about £6 by today's conversion, and you'd get 8 weeks supply of patches and or gum. It was $3 per product. Zyban was also subsidised at that time, and doctors already had nortriptyline on the script, which they could prescribe for people cheaply. Champix came along a little bit later, and eventually there is part funding for Champix to be used. You call them the same, Zyban and Champix here? Yeah. So the Māori Aukati Kai Piper Stop Smoking Face-to-Face service, however, they were able to give out free patches and gum. So we've been doing patches and gum for quite a long time. So how did we come to set this end date? Well, again, it has been Māori and Māori politicians that have pushed this, and the Māori Affairs Select Committee inquiry. The Māori Affairs Select Committee, so a parliamentary committee of MPs, we lobbied in tobacco control, and particularly Māori, we lobbied them to hold an inquiry into the consequences of the tobacco industry in New Zealand, and particularly the consequences for Māori. So this happened in 2010. There was a select committee, people could make submissions, many Māori went and did so, not just NGOs, not just advocates, not just workers, but families as well. And went and talked about the deaths. So we lose about 650 Māori a year to smoking. Nearly everybody has been affected by that among our community. The Māori Affairs Select Committee recommended, there was a long list of recommendations, a huge shopping list. But the important one here is that they recommended halving tobacco consumption and smoking prevalence by 2015, so it's by last year. And that we should aim for a smoke-free nation by 2025. So how did the government respond? Because the Select Committee just makes puts a report to government and then the government gets to respond to that. So they agreed with the goal of reducing smoking prevalence and tobacco availability. Something sort of changed in the wording over the over the last few years. We're sure that they agreed with the figures that were put forward, but it's been changed, and the claim is it's always been minimal levels. There haven't actually been put figures on it, but the tobacco control community claim that the aim is to get New Zealand to 5% or below by 2025. So, and there were specific other targets for Māori smoking rates and Pacific smoking rates. But overall, to get to 5% or below, and then we would be essentially a smoke-free nation. So how have we done, or what have we done to achieve that? Let's see. I already told you what we've been doing since 1990 and the few amendments we've had to the Act. So we've continued our 10% per annum hikes in taxation over the last 9 years. We've introduced a few other little things, and a couple of amendments, one of them reducing the allowance of tobacco you can bring in duty-free from 200 cigarettes sticks to only 50, and then there was similar sort of reduction in tobacco, loose tobacco. We had quite a big problem, well, people would just go overseas, buy it cheap, bring it back, and among the Pacific Island community, they were used to really get this through because they had a practice of gifting, so a cultural practice, which is, and so if they traveled home to the Pacific Islands and then back again, they were supposed to bring gifts. And over the years, this has changed to tobacco being a very valuable gift. You know, once it would have been flax mats and, you know, a pig, now it had got to be tobacco. And everyone in the family who was of age would carry tobacco. So this hopefully has put a little bit of a stop to that, or at least slowed it down. Plain packaging is to come. You would know that Australia has introduced that. New Zealand was supposed to, with our tobacco control policies, we're supposed to sort of have this equalisation thing going on. And we've been waiting for some time now for New Zealand to pass the legislation that we will have plain packaging. The wording's been changed to standardised packaging, and we're still waiting, but it is now going through the House. But New Zealand, being a small country, would be quite concerned about having to go to court. Don't think we can afford that sort of thing against the tobacco industry. So we're waiting. Cessation has been a big part of the strategy. We already had quitline, we already had subsidised products, we already had that. So what's been implemented is the ABC, where everyone pretty much, and health targets for primary and secondary health care. So that 95% of smokers presenting to health care at primary care level, and then it rolled out to secondary care level. It was the other way around, secondary care and then primary care. 95% of people coming in should be asked, do you smoke? That gets recorded, and the minister watches these targets, how people are doing on the ABC. B is be given brief advice to quit, and C was provided with cessation support or referred to a cessation provider. So that's ABC. Pretty good, rolled out through all primary care and secondary care, and some district health boards have, they're getting even more than the target. So setting a target really helped with that, and then quarterly monitoring of that and putting it in the paper how all the district health boards are doing on that target. We've also had $20 million was put into a fund for innovative projects, trials. We've got to find something new. If you keep doing the same thing, you're going to keep getting the same result. We knew we needed to do something different. So money, there's been trials of incentives to help pregnant women stop smoking, which I've been involved in. A quick bus, so a bus that travels around Auckland, and the quit workers will work out of the back of it. People can hop in the van and have a little session, and it goes to events. Competition, so I designed a group stop smoking competition, and that was piloted and then rolled out nationally for Māori and Pacific people. Some projects have designed different apps, one in a university setting where the students were encouraged to design an app, and it was a competition. So there's been a number of sort of different things trialed, and also what did we also had your no smoking day, I think, picked up, and that's been run as well. That's because we had Ben Newton come down to New Zealand. He used to run it up here. Yeah. So I guess that's about what's been happening. The tupika kuri, or tobacco free, again was probably pushed from the Māori tobacco control sector, that we wanted tupika kuri, not just smoke free, but tobacco free. And some district health boards, there have been a couple that have implemented it, put it into their policy. So you can't even, it's not just smoke free on their grounds, you can't even carry tobacco onto the grounds or into the hospital. The Hawke's Bay District Health Board that implemented this policy had quite a challenge with some staff who smoked, especially in mental health. And I know that one, they had to carry through with disciplinary action against a staff member who just would not comply with the employer's rules. So that's whether it's, I don't think that there's like whole agreement to the tobacco-free thing. Smoke-free 2025, as like this logo, is the one that's made out. That's really all we've done to get the rates down. So how have we done? This is the smoke-free prevalence from the New Zealand Health Survey, age 15 years and over, for 2014-15. And here are the Māori smoking rates. So women are sitting at 42%, Māori women 42% smoking prevalence, and men 34%. So we have 38% of Māori smoking, and remember I said when I started 20 years ago it was more than half, and Māori smoking rates were quite a bit higher than that, so high, mid to high 50s. Pacific people, and that's lumping about 7 or 8 Pacific peoples together, and it's so it's more among Samoan men, varies by gender and ethnicity, but lumping them together, about 25% of our Pacific Island population smoke. Very low smoking rates among our Asian immigrant population. So we kind of have a healthy migrant effect happening there. So they don't smoke when they come over anyway. So lower smoking rates. And the New Zealand European and other, some other ethnicities are down to 14%. Now, what's sort of shocking is that There has been no significant change in Māori smoking rates since 2006-2007. There's been no significant drop in Pacific Island smoking rates in that time either. There has been some drop for New Zealand European women, but not for New Zealand European men. So it looks like all of that work we've been doing, we have not reduced smoking prevalence. We certainly haven't halved it. And in fact, it doesn't look like we're getting very far at all with those smoking, with those strategies. I just wanted to show you, of great concern, especially for me, this is a figure from, Māori smoking while pregnant. So this would be at first registration for pregnancy, 34%. And that's from 2010, so it's quite some time ago. But if your background prevalence among women is high, it's not going to come down in pregnancy either. So we haven't had any change, that will pretty much be the same. So still very high smoking prevalence in pregnancy among Māori women. So what more can we do? I mean, we've been discussing a lot of end game strategies. People are lobbying for, do a massive price increase. You know, it's got to be 40% before people are going to change, or at least 20%. This 10% is just too small an increment and people are adapting to it. So there's an argument being put forward to do a massive price increase. That'll do it. Another area of study that I've been involved with some colleagues is looking at what if we take the nicotine out of tobacco. Well, actually we have trade and investment laws that prevent us from doing that, but we can reduce the nicotine to sub-addictive levels, so that's down to less than 0.05 milligrams. Very interesting idea, but unfortunately quite a little bit controversial. Smokers don't tend to like it, and actually I think a lot of people think, oh, they're going to compensate, you know, they're still smoking, which is the harmful thing. Why would you do that? You know, you could increase harm, and so the argument goes on. There's an argument for banning other additives in tobacco, extending the bans on smoking to public outdoor areas, parks, footpaths. We already have some of our beaches have the signs up, so there's no enforcement of it. It's just appealing to people to not smoke on beaches or around children's playgrounds. So there's most of our health promotion workers throughout the country spend quite a bit of time lobbying and working with council to try and get this sort of thing through. There are some people in tobacco control who are trying to, who are advocating for legislation to ban smoking in vehicles where children are present, and that would result in fining smokers. We've never done that before. And then the Singapore tobacco-free generation policy is another one that's being bandied about. So that is where you pick a date. Anyone born in 2020 will never be able to buy cigarettes. So, when they get to be, well, they just never will be able to buy cigarettes. So Singapore has brought that in. And I think Tasmania is looking at doing it as well. And then there's continued sort of push for, we've got to restrict retail sales, you know, let's limit the number of, or the closeness to a school where you can sell tobacco. Let's have a register of outlets, and let's bring in licensing and then clamp that down so you can have less and less outlets selling. And then a new idea is to ban mail order purchases of tobacco from overseas and or anyone sending tobacco from overseas to people in New Zealand. These are all just being discussed, and I would say we don't have consensus on any of them. And I'm chair of End Smoking NZ, an NGO. What we've proposed is kind of, you know, you put some of these together, not don't look at one in isolation, but what if we reduce the nicotine to sub-addictive levels, do it mandatory across the board from, say, 2020, tobacco products, all tobacco products can have no more than 0.05 milligrams of nicotine. Alongside that, do a big tax on, well, we wouldn't need to do the big tax, but you could do the differential thing. You could also increase the price, but then also allow electronic cigarettes, so there's an alternative to for people to move to. So we've been promoting a kind of a package. Any questions about any of those and what they are?
If you reduce the nicotine level across the board, would that lead some smokers to have to smoke more to kind of achieve their level of nicotine dependence, saturation, whatever?
That's the intuitive thought,
yeah.
But we have run a small study where we tested this, and we gave people, so they could buy their own cigarettes, we gave them a carton of nicotine-free cigarettes, or very, very low nicotine cigarettes, the ones we're proposing are allowed to be sold, and then we tracked what happened. So if they could still buy their own cigarettes, what they tended to do was to save money, and half the time they'd smoke the very low nicotine cigarettes, and the rest of the time they would smoke, you know, their full strength cigarettes. So we concluded that if you still have the full strength cigarettes, then people will still smoke those. So they didn't reduce how much, they didn't increase how much they were smoking, but they didn't decrease it either. The people who did switch, who tried to just smoke the very low nicotine cigarettes, tended to wean off. So I thought that was quite promising. So if you took away the full strength nicotine cigarettes, there's just not enough nicotine to be able to compensate you. If you smoke more, you're just not going to get it. So I suppose you could stick a patch on it, and they're still not going to get the hit.
Are we taking questions?
Oh no,
I was just curious, Dr. Glover, Professor Glover, sorry, in terms of what we've done since 2010 and what more can we do? Mass media hasn't been...
Oh, mass media, sorry.
Yeah.
We've done lots of mass media.
Right.
Yeah, since 1990,
right.
We've had mass media campaigns. At first, they were focused on preventing uptake. In fact, most of them have been focused on preventing uptake. And then when Quitline was funded, Quitline got funding to run mass media campaigns, which they used that funding to primarily promote their service. It wasn't to promote quitting as such,
right.
Although obviously there were, but it was quit with us.
So not kind of the approach taken in Australia through the National Tobacco Campaign, as in really hard hitting.
Yeah, those ads still promote their quit line.
Yes.
Yeah, there's still the quit line ads. So.
But there's a really strong evidence base in terms of the role of those campaigns.
We get our ads from there, we can't afford to make our own.
So we've
been very lucky to get the Australian ads and use them. Not the ones they did in Perth. There were some pretty hard-hitting ones.
We're using that now, actually.
Are you?
In the northeast? Yeah,
oh.
16 councils. Yeah, and yeah, I think it's very powerful.
Mm-hmm. So let's see. So why aren't we talking about e-cigarettes? E-cigarettes was not on the list. In Smoking NZ have been pushing e-cigarettes to be considered as part of the package. But the situation in New Zealand is that we just basically have this silence on e-cigarettes. The law in New Zealand, the sale of nicotine-containing e-cigarettes or nicotine e-liquid is actually, if it's for non-therapeutic use, it's prohibited. Nicotine-containing e-cigarettes can only be sold for therapeutic use, that is for smoking cessation, if it's been approved under MedSafe by MedSafe under the Medicines Act. So if a company put an electronic cigarette through, a nicotine-containing electronic cigarette through for registration under the Medicines Act, then that could be sold for cessation. So at the moment, nicotine, this is the next, this, so we had some clauses in our Smoke-Free Environments Act that have been applied to electronic cigarettes. So ENDS electronic nicotine delivery systems with or without nicotine, if they resemble a tobacco product or a smoker's pipe, and they can be used to simulate smoking, so like a toy tobacco product, then it cannot be sold to anyone under 18 years of age. Now this was written a long time before e-cigarettes were even invented. So it was there to, well, it was there to cover the sale of toy tobacco products and to ban those. But that is now being applied to electronic cigarettes. A lot of electronic cigarettes no longer resemble a tobacco product. Can you hold your one up? That does not look like a cigarette. However, it's captured by the next part of the phrase, can be used to simulate smoking. So children used to get these cigarettes, these toys, they'd puff on them, and it would blow out a white powder. So those got banned by this amendment. The positive thing is that we already have legislation preventing the sale of e-cigarettes to under 18-year-olds. The next clause that's been applied to electronic nicotine delivery systems, that if they contain nicotine derived from tobacco, nicotine is derived from tobacco, and it's not registered under the Medicines Act as a medicine, then the quote in the Act is, it is considered an oral tobacco product that is not smoked, and therefore it is illegal to advertise, import it for sale, sell, pack, or distribute. You can't even just give it to anybody. Now this part of the Smoke-Free Environments Act was put there to ban snus, snuff, chewing tobacco, any non-smoked tobacco product. And it's now being applied to electronic cigarettes. So electronic cigarettes that don't contain nicotine can be sold, but we kind of need the nicotine. The Ministry of Health's position, this is off their website, and I keep looking to see if they're going to update it, is that nicotine is derived from tobacco plants and is a psychoactive and addictive chemical that in excessive amounts can be lethal. Which, fairly strong wording. And further on it says, smokers should continue to use approved smoking cessation aids. So that's the Ministry of Health position, and anybody funded by the Ministry of Health has to, I don't know if they've been told they have to stick to that, but they believe they have to stick to that, or they put their funding in jeopardy. So it's our way or the highway at the moment. Anyone funded to deliver smoking cessation advice, which is nearly everybody that does do that, is funded by the Ministry of Health. The New Zealand health targets, as I said, require all primary and secondary care patients to have the ABC, and the cessation part of it, according to the New Zealand Smoking Cessation Guidelines and according to the advice on the Ministry of Health's website about electronic cigarettes, is use the recommended methods. So subsidised nicotine replacement products or medications or quitline or face-to-face services, that's it. Now to be fair, the National Smoke-Free Working Group have said we need a policy response to electronic nicotine delivery systems. The National Smoke-Free Working Group is made up of representatives from NGOs and academics who work in public health and tobacco control, researchers, and they get together and meet bi-monthly and pretty much put together, you know, they lead tobacco control and put out, this is the tobacco control strategy for New Zealand, and these are the 13 priorities. So that group of representatives are setting the policy, and then they tell the ministry what the tobacco control sector want. They go on, and they're in the part of the policy regarding electronic cigarettes to say, in such as electronic cigarettes are a reality for New Zealand consumers, and we have an opportunity to establish optimal regulatory optimal regulatory response based on the precautionary principle. So the precautionary principle is that we need to wait until there is sufficient evidence sometime in the distant future, don't know when, could be 30 years, it's not defined, until we know what the long-term damage will be of vaping. So pretty much it's the precautionary principle is it's best not to do anything in case harm results, and we'll wait to see if any harm is going to result. So that's the argument against electronic cigarettes at this stage. So for the smoker on the street, the barriers to vaping in New Zealand are that the nicotine-containing e-cigarettes or the e-liquid has to be purchased online from overseas, or you can go overseas and buy it, bring it back. It's an urban myth, we don't really know, but people think they can get in with about 3 months supply, or you can order in about a 3 month supply. The demonisation of nicotine, we deliberately, in tobacco control globally, we deliberately demonise nicotine to scare people off smoking. It was one of our strategies. One of the unintended consequences of that, unfortunately, was it scared people off nicotine replacement products as well, and so we kind of had to back people, oh no, these are not as dangerous. But it scares people off using the nicotine e-liquid anyway. So we do have people trying to quit with e-cigarettes and trying not to use the nicotine e-liquid as well. And I think you have a bit of a trend here. I think it's quite common that vapers think they need to get off the nicotine. And so people are sort of trying to wean themselves off it. Then there's unfounded claims that e-cigarettes are a gateway for youth. Youth are going to try an electronic cigarette, and then they're going to go to smoking. And there's no evidence globally so far that that is happening. If anything, it's a gateway. It's like they're coming up to smoking and they go, oh, I'll do that instead, it's healthier. And then there's unfounded fears that e-cigarettes will undermine smoke-free New Zealand. So we have the smoke-free New Zealand, and we're not going to get there if people start blowing white cloud everywhere. Māori women want to use e-cigarettes, and Māori, I think again, it is Māori leading the lobbying and advocacy and openness towards e-cigarettes, because we are seeing, nothing else has worked, and that this might work. And then, you know, some of us, we've given electronic cigarettes to our family. Doctors with Māori members of their family are giving electronic cigarettes to their own family members. We're seeing people quitting, and there's one woman who is not funded by government. She's now running Vape to Save groups. She came to Dave's seminar when he came to New Zealand, and I was very grateful that Dave and Jill came over to, we're trying to educate people, and now she runs Vape to Save groups, which are about financial literacy, but as part of that, the participants receive an electronic cigarette for free. She helps them learn how to order online their nicotine e-liquid. She can help them decide what strength. She's a long long experience as a cessation worker. And they're saving up to $20 a day. So there's like £40 a day that they're saving because vaping is so much cheaper. The other thing that's come out of her groups is that they don't feel driven to eat and thus gain weight. I haven't got the obesity figures here for you, but 60% of Māori are overweight or obese. So we have a... That's the next issue I need to get on to. It's like helping everyone stop smoking. You turn around, you go, what have you done? What are you doing? You know, what? And now that we've got this other problem. And there, you know, there is definitely some grounds for, you know, when people give up smoking, they can expect to put on 5 to 8 kilos and basically returning to the weight they would have been if they hadn't smoked. So there is something in it, but it doesn't account for the large weight gain across the population that we've seen. So there's real sort of, they feel some benefits, and then they're also getting health improvement. Half of 18 to 35 year olds in a survey said that the next good attempt they made, they want to use an e-cigarette. And the researchers, this is in New Zealand, and the researchers went, oh, this is terrible, they want to use an e-cigarette, this is really bad. I was like, this is really good, you know, like, support people to have a go. So what we're facing is a situation of how are we going to get nicotine more accessible for people. Non-nicotine vaping is basically going to be useless for reducing smoking prevalence. And the status quo, if we're left with the status quo, vaping as a total substitute and a replacement for smoking is only going to be available to those who are IT savvy, who have a computer, who have a credit card or know how to buy online. So it's just going to increase the disparities between the New Zealand Europeans and Māori. And Pacific and lower socioeconomic. So I just wish there was some way we could exempt nicotine for vaping from the current Act. If we have to change the legislation, we're looking at least 18 months process. I don't know, I think maybe the Ministry can go back to how their definition and say, maybe we shouldn't be applying that to nicotine e-liquid. Perhaps it's, you know, we could argue, is it an oral product? I might go back and try to argue that it's not an oral product. It's inhaled, whereas the others were, you know, the nicotine was soaking in through the mucous membrane of mouth and throat. So will Kiwi pragmatism prevail? I can only hope so. Certainly, smoke-free 2025 is now more achievable than ever and earlier, if we embraced electronic cigarettes like you have here and other new technologies. And with, you know, we can keep a watching brief on it to see if any unforeseen problems arise. But we could again become world leaders, but I think you're going to beat us. And that's basically my talk on where we're at in New Zealand, and I would welcome questions about that or any ideas if you have thoughts. Will we get to 2025? Yes, please.
Hi. I'm Elsa Ritter, I'm the director of Fresh, which is the Northeast Tobacco Control Programme, and it's just wonderful to have you here, so it's great. We're always looking to steal ideas from elsewhere, and I think, you know, share really learning and things as well. One of the things we're trying to do every year is to keep tracking public support around kind of an endgame philosophy in terms of saying, ultimately, we've got a target it's a vision in the Northeast of 5% by 2025. Fresh positively embraces harm reduction. Fresh, you know, endorses the role that emerging products like electronic cigarettes can play, as long as there is, you know, a level of monitoring, etc. But we're finding it's really important to play back to politicians that the public expects more work around this, and that smokers themselves
really support work to say it will reach a point where this will be a completely smoke-free generation. So basically stop kids taking it up. How's that going in New Zealand? Because I think we need to reassure our politicians that this isn't nanny state gone mad. This is what the public expects us to do.
Okay, I did sort of think I should have bought those uptake figures. Basically, we are delaying uptake. So ASH New Zealand have run surveys in schools and at 14-year-olds for many years, and we have seen that come down. But we don't see any drop in the prevalence among the 18-year-olds. So by the time they get to that, they've taken up. So we've done is delay uptake, which is good, but I think the other thing that would be of interest to you is that the ministry are now currently going through a realignment. It's called a realignment. So all the stop smoking services, the smoking cessation services, the advocacy services, they've all lost their contracts and everyone has to rebid. So it's kind of revolutionary. It will probably will do away with some services. There was, you know, the cost per quota was very high. Some services were not effective. So they'll be gone. And the ones that do get a contract going forward are being expected to do something different. My concern is that there's no, you know, we have evolution in e-cigarettes and, you know, that's new. The cessation practice, the theory driving what you do with someone when they come in is not moving. So it's still largely stages of change theory. And if the theory of behaviour change doesn't move, then they're going to still keep doing the same, offering the same, you know, you can dress it up, but it's still going to be the same, and it's still going to be as ineffective, probably. It'll just be, you know, everyone will think, oh, these are all new services, they can rebrand it, like Quitline, they can rebrand it, they can say, we've got a new program, but to me, the theory underlying what they're doing is all the same. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm just going to ask more about the sort of background to what's going on. For example, why are there so many women, Maori women, more Maori women smoke than men, which is very unusual. I mean, it's, you know,
it's
here in the Northeast, we were worried a few years ago that more women were starting to say.
It's historical. So when tobacco was brought to New Zealand with the whalers, the sealers, the missionaries and the settlers, they used it in trading with Māori, so it was an item of trade. It's a way of creating dependency of the indigenous people on the colonisers. And both Māori men and Māori women were addicted to tobacco in a deliberate kind of way. Although, you know, we could say that the people who smoked then and who were giving out tobacco probably didn't know the effects, but we don't know. I mean, that would be for your historians to determine. Did they actually know that it was that addictive? They gave out alcohol in the same way. So alcohol and tobacco were used in that way, and it created dependency. So Māori women began to smoke say the late 1700s, early 1800s. Whereas European women didn't take it up until the roaring 1920s and 30s. So we have kind of like 100 years of smoking career before the rest of the women in the world. And if you want to know what's going to happen to your women if that epidemic continues to go up in women, then you just have a look at our cervical cancer rates, 3 times the cervical cancer rates for our Māori women compared to European. SIDS rates, all of the effects of smoking during pregnancy, high smoking and pregnancy rates. So we basically can be like a case study of this is what happens if women in large numbers smoke. but you are arresting the epidemic, hopefully. I think your rates of smoking pregnancy have been slowly going up, haven't they?
Down.
Mm.
Down.
Down.
Yep. Oh, that was my question too about the gender difference. But then I was also wondering about alcoholism, which you just mentioned. Is that so significant in the Maori communities? And
yeah.
Then also I was wondering about kind of the contexts of women smoking, like where do they do it, how do they relate to one another when they're doing it, kind of, is there sort of a picture on the ground of kind of how this fits into the daily life of Maori women?
Well, it's been there for so long, so it's intergenerational, it's normalized. I mean, there are some communities, some district health board reports on smoking at first registration for pregnancy, you're looking at 80%. That's the average across the whole country. So some areas, smoking prevalence among Māori women is a lot higher than that average. It's 60% and, you know, and more. It's highest in the younger childbearing age group. So it's been there for such a long time. Where do they smoke? Everywhere. Except where they're not allowed to, and then they just go around the corner. The smoke-free environments doesn't impact on that. For a long time, the lower socioeconomic people, that law didn't even apply to the places where they went. It wasn't blue-collar workplaces, it was the offices, it was white-collar people that law applied to. So with the bars and restaurants, well, again, you know, you just go outside. It's the same with plain packaging, that's not going to make any difference, it's not going to stop anybody smoking. And they say the same thing about the tax increases. So I think that it was in the paper the other day, a calculation that people have lost $28 out of their pocket from these increases over this period of tax increases. And the increases in the benefit and other sorts of increases has been about 25. So it puts me in a very tricky position. I've been on radio supporting tax increases. You know, this was supposed to work. Everyone told us it works. It doesn't work for Māori, and it's hurting our people. We're overrepresented among the lower socioeconomic. People talk about, you know, they're afraid that parents are spending money on tobacco instead of on milk and bread for their kids. Poverty is such a big issue, and I don't know anymore. I really feel very conflicted about supporting any more tax increases when nothing is working. Mm-hmm. If we could have something that actually started to impact on smoking prevalence, you know, then maybe, but it's like, no, whoa, let's just have a, you know, rethink this.
We're thinking of the vaping.
Yes.
we discussed it earlier that one of the junior researchers worked on vaping in Paris. And what they were also using it to stop smoking and then start vaping. And one of the big advantages is that you can do it together. So the sociality of standing in this smoke or whatever vapor and inhaling the joint vaping, it seemed to be something positive. And I was wondering, could you mention that some of that's already being taken up by Māori women. So what is the attraction now of it, other than the attraction that you're not smoking? I mean, is there something good about it, about the e-cigarettes?
If somebody gets an electronic cigarette and the nicotine level is sufficient for, you know, to attenuate the cravings, and they can vape inside or not if they choose. So I got my sister onto an electronic cigarette, and it was a few weeks, and she was sort of giving me updates about how it was going. And, oh, I can vape in the rain. And oh, I just didn't burn myself when I hit the spider off my arm. And then she ended up starting to say it was better than smoking, which was really quite challenging.
So then it's better as an individual technique of managing your nicotine craze.
It was just better in lots of ways. It didn't smell, her skin was getting better. There were just lots of little things that she found were better. She went into a bar and she said to the bar, "Oh, do you mind if I vape here?" And they were like, "Yeah, sure, that's not smoke." And And the smokers got annoyed that, oh, we can't smoke. So she ended up saying it was better. And I think, you know, vapors around the world are trying to say that this is actually better than smoking. Whereas tobacco control, we've never believed anything will ever come close to a cigarette in terms of replacing all of the beneficial experiences. There's so much, you know, the taste, the smell, the nicotine hit, the sociality of it. They can do all of that with vaping.
Then in the current tax situation, is vaping more expensive than smoking cigarettes or cheaper?
It's cheaper. The hardware, the first initial purchase, obviously you've got to outlay for an electronic cigarette. But then a 30ml bottle is $25, and that can last a 20-a-day smoker about a month. So there's a huge saving of hundreds of dollars a month. And for Māori women, especially the ones on this financial literacy course, that's what they're there for, to try and get better control over finances, little finances they have. And that's been a huge benefit for them.
So couldn't then this practice actually become just spread without necessary social marketing campaigns?
Yes, absolutely, yes.
I think it's going to spread.
Yeah, because we can't advertise electronic cigarettes.
No, but maybe you don't need to. It's going to spread anyway.
Yeah, it will spread.
It will spread by word of mouth.
Yeah,
if it's attractive.
Yeah, they tell each other, they see each other, you know, so... It will spread. The problem is getting the nicotine. If we had the nicotine, there is a black market in nicotine. There are a few shops that are selling it, but for a smoker who's looking for entry, they're not going to know that necessarily, unless they happen to go to one of those shops and are sold nicotine liquid. Mm.
Two more questions.
Thank you.
The evidence thing is so key in this and so debated. And so I think you were saying when we spoke last that, you know, it's 95% safer. So I imagine that comes from somewhere. There's nothing at the moment that's convincingly saying it causes some sort of horrible illness that we're going to suffer with. But if there was no study that said that it was safer, would you feel as confident in your position, or did those studies really matter?
I've been saying this before that came out, long way before. I mean, it's if you understand what's in it, then and you understand that. I think I just read on Twitter today from a doctor friend in Australia, propylene glycol has been used to treat eye irritation. So the constituents in the liquid have already been used in medicine in other ways, obviously not to, well, even to inhale. Aerosols have used some of these as carriers before. So probably the only foreign thing we don't know that much about is the role of the flavours. Mm. And there's plenty of research going on looking at those. And three flavours have been identified, I think it's three, Dave, that people should probably steer clear of. And the vaping community is very well developed in the social media and communicate this information very rapidly to each other. I was introduced to the concept of electronic cigarettes probably when they were first came onto the market, and I've been part of sort of thinking we need to seriously look at whether or not this could be an option.
Mm-hmm.
It could seriously help us reduce Māori smoking rates. But we tried in Smoking NZ, we tried to get snus in because, you know, the reduction in mortality and morbidity that Sweden and Norway have enjoyed from having snus, we tried to get it into New Zealand. No way.
What's snus?
The Swedish snus. It's a
The little pack.
This. Yeah, and it's
this.
Okay.
And it,
good girl.
It has the toxins taken out.
No,
just
can't
in
use
the
it.
Mouth. But because we already had that legislation banning oral tobacco, it would have required a change. We couldn't get it in, and the same thing could happen with this, that they'll just say no, we're not changing the law.
Mm-hmm.
So,
Yeah, if we go back to cessation more generally, I wanted to know what success you'd had with community, Maori community-led initiatives, particularly kind of, you know, place-based where a particular community was, and whether you feel that, to what extent you feel New Zealand tobacco control takes account of specific kind of Maori cultural concepts of health,
yeah,
or motherhood, or elders, or, you know, because you mentioned that the kind of standard cessation thing about behaviour change, etc. So yeah. I wonder if you've been able to affect that and whether that worked.
Thank you, that's a great question. Just this morning I heard that a Māori leader had died, Tahuna Manhinek. And he developed in the early 1990s, he was before me, and he was one of the people that inspired me. His program, he wanted to get a gym onto every marae, which is a traditional Māori meeting place throughout the country, a gym. And his program was fitness, stopping smoking, using karakia, which are Māori prayers, using water. Water has spiritual and healing significance, so he had that. He would teach people the karakia to say to themselves for craving to get them through, and nutrition. So it was combining all those things, and plus it was having the family doing that together, the community. So basing it in the community and changing the lifestyle, including all of those things. So I picked that up from him and from other Māori. There was one program where they took smokers onto the marae. When you got there, that was the end of your smoking, and then they stayed there for 2 weeks. So a detox, it was like a detox. And interestingly, they did kind of this detox diet as well. And that was so challenging, and they had more problem with the diet. They always said that was harder for them to go without foods and drink coffee and stuff like that. So that one worked, but very expensive to do that, very intensive to go and do a residential program, although Mayo Clinic in the States have a residential stop smoking. So I've always, with Okati Kaipaipa, the Māori one, always said you need to deal with nutrition, you need to increase physical activity levels, you need to teach relaxation techniques. So today, Jane at the symposium took us through some breathing exercises, and I said to her afterwards, oh, we used to call that guided meditation. And I included that in my training of the Māori smoking cessation workers. So we did visiting spiritual sites, helping them get the knowledge back, doing it together as a family. So I'm more holistic, and that's based on the Māori approach. So some of those Māori providers still do that, I think. But I guess nothing's really being funded. I developed the Māori Stop Smoking competition based on Māori models, and that was rolled out. But then it's sort of like things morph. They just, you put something out and it just gets dragged back to the Western way of doing things. Mm. And then it loses its efficacy, and it's like being very frustrating for me to, you know, to design something and it works when you do a pilot of it and you have the test, and then it goes out there and gets dragged back, especially if it goes under a service that's funded by the Ministry of Health, and they seem to be pressured to, no, you can't work after hours, you know, it's Monday to Friday, you know, all those sorts of things encroach. So there have definitely been approaches, but they just don't seem to get funded sufficiently and or funded so they can continue to be delivered in that effective way. Does that make sense? Yeah, so we just keep trying. Thank you very much.
Come to an end now. Thanks very much, Marewa, for a really fascinating insight into New Zealand, and particularly Maori kind of experiences with smoking and smoke-free. And we may not be we may be a smoke-free building, but we're not an alcohol-free building. There is wine available and other refreshments outside. So let's go outside and continue our conversations over a glass. Thank you.